So we are going having a talk here tonight, obviously very relevant to the location we're in and the town of Newcastle West, on the Courtney family and their involvement in the town. And we are delighted to have Pat O'Connor giving the lecture, a very noted local historian and author, author of course of the book Hometown, which is vital reading for anyone interested in the Courtney family and the history of Newcastle West. We will allow some time for questions at the end, the usual question and answer format. I suppose you didn't come here to listen to me, you came here to listen to Pat, so I'd ask you to please give him a very warm round of applause.
Well, the reason I'm here is that I'm subbing for my esteemed friend John Cussell, who recently had a hip operation only 3 weeks ago. And John, in his sanguinity, thought that he'd be able to perform. But as the line hold, this hip operation will do nothing after 3 weeks. Well, nothing very much in any event, if you want. So it's a pleasure to stand in and do this job, I suppose, well, partly on John's behalf. But the presentation, of course, one makes one's own of the hands that stealth, and I'll attempt to do that. Albert Einstein said that things should be made as simple as possible, but no simpler. I absolutely concur with that contention. But I think by way of preamble, just a few things that I would say. One is that what we're dealing with in the early modern period, virtually the world over, is imperialism as a generic phenomenon. And what that means is a basic, recognizable kind of phenomenon. And it entailed the invasion of territory by outsiders, you know, superior in terms of their development across all strata or spheres, resulting in this subjugation of the invaded people to alien rule. That's one that's timeless and ubiquitous. It's one of the great forces in history, and it happened, of course, in Ireland. But I mean, it happened in Ireland, and I think the questions then we have to address is what actually happened? And I think that'll do me for history, you know. I wouldn't, like John Bruton, say you could do without 1916, it could be done without. It happened, and that's a fact. And there's no need for a counterfactual history. It's no use at all. Nor need one heavily overlaid with any kind of ideology. So what actually happened? And how areas were changed. And in the context of the title tonight, I think we can address both of those issues. What actually happened sequentially, you know, through the exposure of a series of maps, you know, a series of cross-sections in time, that largely, how have areas been changed? Well, I suppose I have all put it neatly, well, I think it's neat enough, in a very large book, which was a devil of a thing. You know, I remember the historian Margaret McCorton launched it in this hall in 1998. I remember commenting then that if the dust jacket were pulled out end to end, it was akin to the wingspan of an eagle. And I advise people strongly never to do a book like this, because it's a devil of a thing to store, for one thing. In libraries, it belongs in oversize or outsize or sort of beyond the bounds of size. But on the other hand, I describe it myself as a kitchen table book, you know, not a coffee table book. I think Sean Kelly, who exhorted me to write a book in Newcastle, what Sean said was, he said that he, you know, someone would do a book in Newcastle. And the way he put it was, he didn't want a half-assed one, you know. So I did my best to come up to the specification he intended, although I'd say never intended that I should do anything as large as this particular tome. But anyway, let's get down to it. So what actually happened, how many areas were changed, specifically Newcastle and the Courtney estate in West Limerick? Well, the first thing is the coat of arms there, is the coat of arms of Sir William Courtney. It tracks back to the medieval period, and Sir William Courtney, bearer of the name, in 1587 was the undertaker who settled, who didn't settle very much, in West Limerick. The significance of the first coat of arms I know little about, except it's clearly, you know, relatively understated. You know, the motifs basically are triads, circles and triads and units. And this one, the second one here, is a later coat of arms. And it's interesting again, you know, the kind of understatedness of these people from the English West Country, you know, Devon, Exeter, Powderham Castle specifically. And basically you have a tremendous line of continuity going back to the early medieval period and coming forward all the way to our own time. There are two separate lines, you know. The line lapsed for a while and sort of was resuscitated and restored again, and is in a healthy state presently, as we'll see. Where have I fallen? What have I done? Well, arguably, they fell very well in the case of their estates in West Limerick. You know, got a tremendously large acreage and much of it choice land. Certainly the lowlands were choice lands. The hill country was something that had to be wrestled with, and in a sense has been wrestled with ever since. And I mean, the tenants themselves took to it fairly belatedly. Where have I fallen? What have I done? We've got the Latin equivalent there in at the moment. Well, this is their ancestral setting. Goes back a very long time indeed. Goes back into the medieval period. Powderham Castle in Devon. I'm sure some people here have been there. I never have been, but I was in touch, especially when I was doing this in the book Exploring Limerick's Past, with the Devon Record Office in Exeter. And I got a lot. In fact, I was the pioneer ferreter out of a pile of documentation relating to the Courtney estate. Now, Newcastle is a medieval town, although we know little about it. Its origins are medieval. The name itself, Novo Castro, in the Latin, betokens a medieval settlement. And in 1298, which is as early as one can go back, it had assumed an urban form of some sort, because it consisted of the castle with buildings inside the wall as well as without. And the castle was located approximate to here, just over across the way. In fact, maintaining continuity of site, or continuity of site was maintained from the earliest castle all the way through to the castle that was burnt in 1922. But we know relatively little about it throughout the medieval period, or indeed up as far as the surveys which preceded the Munster Plantation, the Desmond Survey and the Peyton Survey. And in the Desmond Survey, you know, it's tantalising, you get some tantalising glimpses into the shape of the place, or the possible shape of the place. One can say no more than that. So what you had was the castle with buildings inside the wall as well as without. And by the 1580s, there was also the rudiments of a street pattern. There were certainly, I mean, two streets I reckon are easily recognisable, although one, curiously, and I mean, there's obviously a story that goes with it, one of them is, of all places, Goat Street. Sometimes I think the latter-day inhabitants of Goat Street know nothing about its etymology, its early origin and evolution. Now, what happened in the case of Goat Street was that the English surveyors mistransliterated a name, mistransliterated a family name. The family name is Dore, and if you know the Irish for Dore, it comes remarkably close to Gower, a goat in Irish. Gower, Michal O'Gower. There was a famous chemist here in town, and his son Michal was a very fine local historian. So that was the origin of the name. And the same fellow, Edmund Dore, he also owned a mill, which was mill and guard, the same thing, you know. So they simply mixed up the family name Dore with Gore, a goat, and hence a name that stuck with remarkable tenacity to what's now known as South Quay. And it's only known as South Quay in the relatively recent past. Now, your idea maybe of recency might tally with mine, you know. The recent past for me would be the 19th century, well into the 19th century, before it was known as South Quay. So even the Ordnance Survey, the first edition, the Ordnance Survey map, it's known as Goat Street. And on a series of maps that I show you, you'll see it recurring over and over and over again, as not with that kind of frequency, but you'll find it as Goat Street. The other one was Shroud and Tona, which I think might conceivably be Shroud and Champel. Might be, one can do no more than speculate. And basically, there you have some, obviously it's easy to postulate some kind of linkage between the castle ensemble here and the medieval church dedicated to St. David in Churchtown. There must have been some through route between the two places. And that makes sense. I would also suggest that what you had, what's in the square now, was at least an open space. I'm not sure to the extent it was built around or built up. And you had streets running off that, you know. I think you had something the equivalent of Bridge Street. And I would certainly make a claim for Maiden Street, you know. Because when you first see Maiden Street, it comes almost fully formed, you know, in 18th century maps. So I would say, and the name, of course, is intriguing. Goat Street is intriguing in its way. Maiden Street is also highly challenging in the sense of Maiden Street, for a street where Michael Hapnett, the poet, my near neighbour, indeed in the Sumter Park, long ago, I'd say. Now, Michael Hapnett said, a street where maidenhood was as rare as a Nessus pullover. Now, the first map on the basis of a precise survey, commissioned obviously by the Devon, the Courtney estate agent, 1709. 1709 by Thomas Moland, who was, I think, probably the best of the land surveyors of his time. So he produced an album of maps, the International Library of Dublin, in an album, 23 maps, the first of which is this one here. So you see Newcastle in 1709, you know, in a state of relative maturity. Obviously you can see the castle ensemble, and also the square is built up, and it is a built up entity. In the middle of it, you have what may pass as a market house. That's the likeliest candidate in any event. See how well formed and shaped and so on Maiden Street is, you know? Not quite the curvy linear representation that it clearly holds and has held it for a long time. You can see also South Quay, the true route is to the medieval church, and the beginnings of what ultimately became known as Bishop Street. You also see the surrounding townlands there, beyond the castle, which ultimately made the castle the main. And an assemblage of tenants' lands as well. So what you've got with the Munster Plantation was a veneer of New English settlement. And curiously and interestingly, among the names coming in from the English West Country is the name Upton. And John Upton rang me today to ask me if it was all right to video this event tonight, and I said, well, I'd be mentioning the name Upton, so the fact that John is here sort of doubly ensures that, you know. So the name Upton is an old Cornwall name, as I understand it, and came in at that time. Other names like Copley, Clear. And there was a woman called Mrs. Clear who used to look after catering in this very establishment, in this very building, when the golf dances used to be held, you know, back in the 1950s, I'd say, late 40s, early 50s. The source for that is my old postman, Tony Roach, who used to help out on these occasions in an impeccably white coat. Everything was done then with sort of great taste and decorum, done in the proper manner, you know, etiquette was observed. The name Clear, Farmer, Mead is another one of them, Newton and Upton, as I've mentioned.